Thank you, Chairman. Allow me to introduce the names of the co-authors. That is Dawoho, Ingrid Verbuijten, Matthias Hiller and Mandelieu. So this work is about PUF-based key generation or also fuzzy extraction. And for this problem, there is a default solution or a default architecture available. So suppose we have an embedded device. This embedded device is an integrated circuit. And this IC will house a PUF. So the PUF will produce a device-unique fingerprint, similar to human biometrics. So for this purpose, the PUF will produce thousands of bits, thousands of response bits. And these bits are noisy and non-uniform. And in the end, we want to have a secret key that is, for instance, a 128-bit key that is stable and uniform. So we need to solve two problems. One is the noisiness, and two is the non-uniformity. So to do that, we need some additional digital logic in between, and that is referred to as a fuzzy extractor. So the fuzzy extractor consists of two steps. First, there is the error correction. So here we get rid of the noisiness problem. So the secure sketch is the building block to do that, and it relies on an error correcting code. And it will also need some public helper data. So we have thousands of public helper bits that are available to the attacker. So the attacker has read access to these bits. And then finally, we end up with a stable secret, but it is still non-uniform. So the second step of the fuzzy extractor is a hash function. So here we basically downsize the secret so that we go from non-uniform to uniform. And now the question that we address is, can we make this default architecture more efficient? So without making any changes to the design of this architecture, can we make it more efficient? And more efficient here means that we use less PUF bits and also less helper data bits. And because we have left less PUF bits and less helper data bits, it also means that the secure sketch has to process less data and also the hash has to process less data. So that is the main question that we address here. So now we go to the presentation outline. So first some preliminaries, first about the PUF and then about the secure sketch. So in this presentation, we mainly cover the secure sketch. And in the paper, there is an extensive theory part, actually more than half of the paper, where we derive tight bounds on the secure sketch mean entropy loss. And it are these bounds that are responsible for the savings in implementation overhead. We have to make an apology here because we only do a brief introduction of the theory. Because the theory is formula-based, and in order to explain it properly, we would need more time than we have. So what we do instead here is we focus on the applications of the theory. And we hope that these applications may spark your interest to also take a look at the theory in a more convenient written form. So the first obvious application of the theory is to reduce the implementation overhead of the fuzzy extractor. So we use less PUF bits and less helper data bits without changing anything to the architecture. But there are other applications. In general, the theory is useful to analyze various error correction methods for PUFs. So one application is that we can show that there is a flaw in the security proof of the reverse fuzzy extractor. So the reverse fuzzy extractor, that's a special mode of operation of the fuzzy extractor. And third, we provide proper motivation for debiasing schemes because we think this was a bit missing in the original proposals. And for these two last applications, here we put two papers from the last chess edition in a somewhat different spotlight. So we have now the preliminaries. So this work applies to array-based PUFs, which can be informally referred to as the copy-paste PUF. So what we do, we have an array of identical cells, and each cell will produce exactly one bit. So to design a PUF like that, you just design one cell and then you copy-paste it in your layout. So we have thousands of cells that produce the device-unique identifier, and later this is post-processed better into a secret key. So examples of PUF architecture that comply with this array-based structure are the memory-based puffs, for instance, the SRAM puff, the DRAM puff, which is covered in the next presentation. Also, the D flip-flop puff applies to this context. There is also a ring oscillator based design that matches the criteria. Also, the coating puff. Not included are arbiter puffs and variations. So we have two issues that need to be resolved to use the puff identifier as a secret key. One is the noisiness, so there is a bit error rate between 1% and 20% with respect to a reference response of the puff. And second, there are non-uniformities. And for array-based puffs, there are two predominant non-uniformities. One is bias, so it can be the case that there are more ones than zeros, or vice versa. And the other predominant imperfection are spatial correlations, implying that neighboring cells influence each other. So in this example, bit string, it is a case that the neighboring bits tend to have the same value. So we are still at the preliminaries, and now the secure sketch, because this is the main focus of our theory. So the secure sketch relies on an error correcting code, and most frequently, this will be an NKT block code. So we have a message, which is kbit, and this message is encoded into a code word having nbit. And n is larger than k, so there is a certain redundancy built-in. And because of this redundancy, we can decode a corrupted code word again into the original message, as long as the number of errors is not exceeding t. So various secure sketch constructions rely on an error-correcting code, on an NKT block code. However, these constructions will also publish helper data which is available to the attacker. So because the helper data is published, there is a loss in mean entropy because the attacker gains some information. So on the left, we have the entropy at the input, which is represented here with a thermometer scale. So the fraction in red is the mean entropy at the input. And then on the right, we have the mean entropy at the output, taking into account that the attacker observes the helper data. So there is a drop in mean entropy. And when implementing a puff-based key generator on an embedded device, system providers will always rely on the n minus k upper bound on the mean entropy loss. So given the mean entropy at the input, if we subtract n minus k, that is an upper bound on the loss, as visualized here. However, this upper bound is in many cases overly conservative. So we have more mean entropy left than the bound indicates. And this is an inefficiency. So the goal of this work is to make it more efficient, so to derive new bounds. So we derive tighter lower and upper bounds on the mean entropy loss. So these are indicated in red here. And using these bounds, we can make the puff-based key generator more efficient. It is also important to mention that these bounds are easy to evaluate. So it is easy to get numerical results. It is just a matter of milliseconds to seconds on a conventional or a standard PC. So is there a related work that aims to improve upon the n minus k bound? Not too much, actually. It's a fairly new research direction. So there are, to the best of our knowledge, only two papers cover this. And for these two papers, it is not even the main topic, but only a small side contribution. However, the practical applicability of the existing work is limited, because it only covers, so far, repetition codes. So repetition codes are very easy to analyze because there are only two code words, the all zeros code word and the all ones code word. It's easy to analyze. However, if you want to implement a puff-based key generator, you need different codes. You need more powerful, larger, more complex codes. So this is interesting for theory, but not for practice yet. And also the distribution of the puff that is covered is quite limited. It is assumed that the puff bits are independent and identically distributed. So the best that we can cover here is the bias case. So here, as represented by the bit string, we have a distribution, and it is assumed that the puff bits are independent, and the probability that a certain bit is 1 is equal to a parameter b. And b is somewhere between 0 and 1. So if b is 0.5, this would be uniform, but here in the example, b is greater than 0.5, like 0.7 or something, and then you have more ones than zeros on average. So now we considerably extend the scope on two fronts. First, we are able to cover large complex codes as they are used in a practical key generator. So we can cover, for instance, BCH code, Reed-Muller code, a concatenation of codes. And second, we can cover various PUF distributions. So we cannot cover any possible distribution, but there are some limitations on what we can cover, but for sure, the variety that we can cover is larger than before. And here, in the manuscript, we mainly focused on one proof of concept distribution, where we have a spatial correlation. So here is an example bit string, and in the example, we assume that the probability that two neighboring bits are equal, that is a certain parameter C, with C between 0 and 1. So if C is, for instance, 0.7 or 0.8, then it means that neighboring bits tend to have the same value. So now we move to the applications. So there are three applications. So here is the first one. So the obvious application is to reduce the implementation footprint of the PUF-based key generator. And a key generator will have some specifications, so we use typical specs. Like we want to use, or we want to generate a 128-bit key. We use a BCH code that is concatenated with a repetition code. The bit error rate of the PUF is on average 10%. And the failure rate for a repositioning key is smaller than 10 minus 6. So these are very typical specs, so there is nothing special here. And now we compare the overhead of the the resources for the key generator using the n minus k bound versus the new improved bound. So there are two colors, red is the n minus k bound, blue is the new bound. So we have a plot here, and on the horizon, we illustrate it for the bias distribution, but we can also do it for other distributions, but now let's keep it simple and do it for the IID bias distribution only. So in the horizontal axis, we have the parameter B, so the magnitude of the bias. So the larger B, the more ones versus zeros. And on the vertical axis, we have the number of PUF bits that are needed to generate this 128-bit key. So if you use the N minus K bound, you get quite quickly into trouble already. So a small bias is sufficient for you to be unable to instantiate a key generator that satisfies all the constraints. While with a new improved bound, it is much easier. So for the same bias, you will need less PUF bits. So we can support a bias up to 0.65. So two side notes here. We will use less PUF bits with a new bound, but we will also use less helper data bits, which is not represented here. And also, this is for the bias distribution, but we can also do this for other distributions, like the spatial correlated distribution from the previous slide, and there is a similar gap between the n-k bound and the new bound. So now we move to the second application out of three applications, and that is the security analysis of the reverse fuzzy extractor. So that is a special mode of operation of the conventional fuzzy extractor. And that is mainly a technique to reduce the implementation footprint of PUF-based protocols. So there have been several protocol proposals that rely on this technique. So first we take a look at the conventional strategy. So this is not the reverse one that is depicted here, but the conventional strategy. So suppose we have a two-party protocol. On the left we have an embedded device, and on the right we have a server. So on the embedded device we do PUF-based key generation. So we have the secure sketch, we have the hash function, so we generate a secret key. And the server will store a copy of this key. And once we have established a symmetric key, we can do any crypto protocol that we want. So for instance, authentication protocols. Now, the reverse strategy is slightly different. So here, with every protocol run, new helper data is transferred from the embedded device to the server. And this allows to implement the error correcting code, or at least the most hardware intensive decoder part, on the server instead of on the device. So this is more lightweight. And a small side effect thereof is that the key is not static anymore but dynamic, but that's only a footnote. So you can still do any symmetric key protocol that you want. So the main security claim of the reverse strategy is that it is equally secure as a conventional one. Or more formally stated, it is claimed that repeated helper data exposure does not result in additional mean entropy loss. And the proof is borrowed from a 2004 paper from Boyan. However, there is a flaw in this transfer because Boyan imposes a certain condition that is not satisfied in the reverse fuzzy extractor case. And to be specific, it is overlooked that the attacker can, due to the repeated helper data exposure, that the attacker can for every puff bit determine what is the exact bit error rate of that bit. So we give now the intuition why the exposure of bit error rates leads to more mean entropy loss. And we do this for the biased puff distribution, the IID biased puff. This is just one example because there is a similar reasoning for spatial correlation. But let's keep it simple and do bias only. So here in this case, we have 70% is 1 on average and 30% is 0. Now, if you look at the puff error statistics for shifted distribution, it is the case that the ones have a lower bit error rate on average than the zeros. So given now that an attacker knows for every bit the exact bit error rate, this will help to distinguish between 0 and 1, so that's a clear mean entropy loss. In practice, however, the protocols that rely on the reverse fuzzy extractor are not that much affected. That's because they also rely on the N-k bound, and the N-k bound is overly conservative. So this, the fact that it is overly conservative gives some additional security margin that is now consumed by this unanticipated loss that was not included. Now we have the third and last application, so motivation for debiasing schemes. So there have been several proposals. One is the IBS scheme, and the other one is the von Neumann scheme, and both have been gradually improved over time. So all these schemes conjecture that a standalone sketch cannot handle bias, and this is indeed correct if we make use of the N-k bound, as we have seen before. So the idea behind all of these schemes, or what all these schemes have in common, is that they start with a biased IID puff, and then they will convert this biased distribution into a uniform distribution. So they will do this by selecting a subset of the response bits only. So there is additional helper data to indicate which bits are selected and which are discarded. And this allows to restore the balance between the number of zeros and the number of ones. And then what comes after is just the conventional fuzzy extractor. So we have the secure sketch and the hash as it was before. So now this is the same plot as we have seen before, but we just add two additional curves. So on the curve in light blue is the von Neumann scheme, or the von Neumann debiasing, followed by a secure sketch, and then in green we have the IBS scheme, also followed by a secure sketch. And on the horizontal axis we still have the bias, and on the vertical axis we still have the number of puff bits that is needed to generate a 128-bit key. So it can be seen that in the low bias region, the new bound is competitive. In the high bias region, though, there one can say that there is a need for debiasing schemes because a standalone sketch, even with a new improved bound, cannot handle that. Or maybe better, a puff-free design, because if your puff has a bias of 80% or 90%, this is mostly an indication that there is a clear problem with your puff. So there is, if you look at the transistor level of the puff, there will probably be some kind of an asymmetry that is causing this large bias. So maybe instead of applying the IBS scheme or the von Neumann scheme, it might actually be a better idea to take a look at the puff and to make some and to remove the asymmetry in your design to have a lower bias. But in any case, in the low bias region, the new bound is competitive. And there are some additional elements that are in favor of using a standalone sketch versus the debiasing schemes. One is that debiasing is not for free. So we need to select a subset of the bits, and this will require some circuitry, and also, maybe more importantly, a significant amount of helper data. And a second, the IBS and von Neumann debiasing schemes are designed for the IID bias puff in specific, but with the standalone sketch and a new improved bounds, we can cover more distribution. So it is a more generic technique. So in summary, last slide, we have a theory part where we derived tight bounds on the secure sketch min entropy loss for array-based puffs, so SRAM-like puffs. And this is a fairly new resource direction, so it is certainly open for further improvements and further exploration. And then we have several applications. So we reduce the implementation footprint of the fuzzy extractor in comparison to the N-k bound. And furthermore, we show that there is a flaw in the reverse fuzzy extractor security proof, so that is open for repairs. And last, we motivate the need for debiasing schemes, although low bias puffs can do without in principle. So thank you for your attention.